So I'm intrigued by this. Talk me through backstroke. How do you make improvements in backstroke? What are the things that you did in order to go from someone that never really swam the stroke to a couple of years later being the best in the world at it? What are the things that you and Jonty worked on in terms of your technique to make improvements?
It was definitely it had everything to do with my starts and my underwaters, because coming in, I'd never done any short course swimming. And one of the first things Jonty wanted to work on was my underwaters, because of the focus of the underwater in short course yards, racing, short course meters. And that was the first big improvement we made, was all about underwaters, getting off the wall, starts, turns, just really focusing on those for the first couple, I guess, for the first 2 years I was in college, just trying to get those down. And then specifically with backstroke, it was all about stroke rate. My arms were moving too slow. I'm not the tallest guy in relation. I'm about 6'4". And having my arms move at an incredibly fast speed was something that we really had to work on. We were on the towers. We're doing fast moving stuff with very light weight. So not much weight on the power tower. But one of the main things I did work on was with my backstroke catch was not going too deep. I feel a lot of swimmers try to dig deep and more power through the stroke. Whereas I was talking to Jonathan one day and he was like, what does Ryan Lochte do on the backstroke? I was like, I don't know. He kind of just puts his arm in and pulls. He's like, no, he's very shallow in the water. He's very close to the surface. And he explained that you only need about 20 pounds of force to propel yourself through the water at, well, I don't know, maximum velocity or at a good velocity or something like that. And that was something I focused on was, and it increased my stroke rate at the same time, was pulling my hand closer to the surface and spinning that arm around, which I think that really, really helped me. And ultimately, probably that's what gave me the speed in the 50 back, 100 back to, I don't know, eventually win the world champs.
What are you doing with your body when you're spinning your arms really fast? What are you focused on through your head position and your core and maybe even your rotation?
It's very important for me to stay still. Jonty has this thing where you have to make yourself a canoe shape. So I'm pitching my shoulders a little bit forwards, creating like that boat shape in the water. But I've tried and be, because my arms are moving so fast, I have to keep my upper body really still. Really flat, almost not much deviation, just reducing drag as much as we can.
Nice, I like that. So what are some of your favorite backstroke drills for that?
It's like this rotation where you set your shoulders in that canoe position and you just take about six kicks each side and just kind of float side to side. I really enjoy that one. And there's a series of balance drills we do with the pool boy. We'll put it between our legs and we'll rotate 360 degrees, keeping your core tight but flexible, keeping your torso still and just kind of rotating that way, 360, rotating the opposite way, 360, just really focusing on creating that canoe shape and creating a stability within the upper body. And it's the same with the legs. My legs are just up and down. I know there's some swimmers that rotate slightly with their kick. But I like to keep it very flat, very smooth. So I'm not creating much turbulence in the water whilst I'm swimming.
Nice. Now, talk me through. Are you focused on a high elbow in your backstroke when you're catching the water? And then how do you actually pull the water down towards your thighs?
Yeah, so I think I'm definitely focusing on a more because every time I was entering, it was too close to my head. So I was focusing on creating more of the V. And I guess it's kind of a high elbow, but my hand is still very close to the surface and I'm pulling down. And when I push the water down towards my thigh, I'm kind of flicking my hand upwards. And then so that my thumb shoots out of the water first, rotate, repeat.
Oh, okay. Beautiful. I like that. Now, you're also thinking about being synchronized and balanced at the same time on both sides?
Yes. We worked a lot on connection in swimming, both freestyle and backstroke with Jonty, where we worked on he explained it like a camel runs right foot, right arm at the same time, left foot, left arm at the same time. And that really made sense to me in my head when I'm my hands by my right hand finishing at my thigh, my right leg should be finishing the kick, and just keep that connection. It keeps me really on balance through the water.
Oh, wow. Now, did you work on any timing or tempo type things to, you know, get that connection?
I was just playing around with it. I hadn't used a tempo trainer until Coley came in for my senior year with that sort of stuff. But I was mainly just playing around and really feeling through my throughout my body and feeling how it feels. We do a lot of eyes closed stuff with John. He loved doing that, closing your eyes whilst you swim at 25 for a couple strokes and just kind of see how it feels and how it works. And then just trial and error. It was all trial and error.
Now talk to me about the dolphin kick itself. How do you make improvements in your dolphin kick?
For me, it was, I had Luke Kalizak there. He was junior, senior when I was there for 2 years. And he had incredible underwaters, probably, I would say, among the top 10 in the NCAA. And I have him there to kind of walk me through the underwaters. But with my underwater, I was just useless. There was no kicking happening. So just kicking in and of itself was an improvement. And a lot of weight room work, squats, rear foot elevated squats, just strengthening my legs was the main part. And then focusing my undulation outside from my chest down, keeping everything else still.
Now, when you're in a streamlined position, where's your head? Is your head squeezed between your shoulders, or is your head, your shoulders behind your head?
My head is in front of my shoulders. So I would, a tighter streamlined position where my head's kind of popping out.
Okay. Now, as you're doing your dolphin kick, are you trying to keep that, you know, from the chest up to the fingertips, are you trying to keep that locked in and very still, or is there movement in that upper body?
I try and keep it locked in, but I'm not trying to be rigid throughout the water because that can be detrimental. So sort of like semi-flexible, but I try and focus on keeping it very still just to reduce the drag.
Now, was there somebody that you were studying? Like, did you study Ryan Lochte during this period?
I would watch videos of him. Michael Phelps had some pretty amazing underwaters. I would look at those. We had copious amounts of film from Luke Kalizak, and just guys that swam at the university before. And we'd have Wednesdays where Johnson would pull out the TV and he'd have the whole sprint group sit around and watch videos, and he'd have drawings on the screen and stuff like that. So just every Wednesday we'd look through that. And I'd go home and watch just on YouTube race video of Lochte, of Phelps, all the big swimmers that have amazing underwaters.
Okay, so I've got the chest to the fingertips. Now talk to me about kind of the rest of the body. What's the movement and what are you thinking in the movement in the dolphin kick? Basically, what are you thinking in your torso, first of all?
So with my torso, basically from my middle chest up, I'm trying to still keep kind of still, kind of flex, like flexy stiff almost. But everything from the bottom down, I try and think of it as a double-sided whip. So I'm trying to get that wave through my body and then whip my feet down, wave up, whip my feet up, just so I'm kicking both ways. That was something I had to really work on, was kicking both ways, because I'm a very one-sided dominant kicker. So to focus on my backwards kick was very important to activate my hamstrings. That just that bottom whip, up whip sort of action.
Wow, interesting. Now, what are your feet doing when you're coming down for the bottom whip and then you're coming up for the top whip? Are you doing anything in particular with your feet?
We would do a lot of ankle flexibility exercises during dry land with John T in the beginning. And to have those flexible ankles to further emphasize that whip action, but I wasn't doing anything specific rather than just keeping my ankles relaxed so I can get that extra whip.
So you're not thinking about kind of curling your toes down and then flicking your toes up or anything particular with your toes or anything like that?
No, nothing like that. Yeah.
Okay, good. Now, how do you get somebody to stop kicking from their knees? How do you get that whip action itself?
I think it has a lot to do with the positioning of your hips. I really focus on rotating my hips backwards and forwards as I'm kicking. And also to focus that it comes out of, like, from the top of my abs down. That's where the work is supposed to come from. Your quads aren't supposed to get that tired in relation to your abs and your hips when you're doing the underwater kicking. Because if your quads are getting tired and your hamstrings are getting tired, you're kicking from the knee. So to get that hip backwards and forwards out of the abs, that's something that I like to focus on.
I like that. Good advice there. Nice. Now, what about your knees and your ankles? Are they locked in together, or is there some separation there?
I like to keep them pretty tight together. It was drilled into us to reduce drag. So everything to reduce that little amount of drag, because in sprinting, you don't have much. You have 0.1, 0.01 in some instances, to either win the race or lose the race. So I like to keep them pretty tight together just to create a seal, just shoot through the water.
Now, what are some of the things that you did to improve your speed of your kick and maybe the power of your kick? Is there anything specific other than just the light buckets that you talked about? Was there anything else that you were doing?
I think it had a lot to do with me just growing up. When I came in, I was a scrawny little kid from a farming town in South Africa. So coming here, we actually got into the weight room. They got me on some weight gain shakes. And I bulked up. I went from maybe 160, 165 coming in, really skinny kid. And I shot up to like 195. And just having that mass behind it really improves the power and the explosiveness of my underwater kicking and my swimming.
Did you do a lot of underwaters in terms of, breath holding? Like, you know, were you putting a lot of stress on those underwaters during practice?
I like to say I'm better at it now, but I wasn't really a fan of holding my breath. It really hurt. It just wasn't my favorite part of swimming. So I try and maybe cheat a little, not quite go 15, to maybe get an extra breath or two in there, but I'm much better at it now, sticking to my kick count, 6, 7, 8 kicks to get to 15, and focusing on holding my breath.
Was there a specific set that you did in order to improve like that last wall? Like, was there a last turn set or anything like that that you guys had where it was like, okay, we're going to emphasize coming off that last wall and kicking out to 15 meters?
I think every single set we did, both Jonty and Coley remind me when I'm swimming is like, focus on this wall, focus on the last wall. And it goes to show at this past SUCs, that's where I lost 100 free, was in that last wall. Cause I think I came up at 12 and a half or something like that. It's just 0.01. But in every set they're emphasizing, you got to focus on your underwater kicks. Got to hold your breath. You really got to shoot out of that 15 yard.
Are you doing a lot of speed kicking, or is there a slow kicking involved as well? Is it a mixture of the two?
Coming off the wall in a race?
Just in terms of improving your underwaters, are you doing a lot of slow underwaters, or is it all at speed?
It's variable. There are some days where we do long, big, slow kicks with the monofin on, and then we'll put on small fins and blast a 25 underwater kick. We'll throw in some big fins for kind of in the middle. But big fins are usually also still the fast 25s. But when we put mono fins on, and that's about technique, getting that feel, that flow with it.
Oh, do you know what brand of mono fin you guys are using?
I have no idea. It's yellow. I have no clue.
Okay. It might be a Finis one. I'm not sure. Yeah. I haven't used them in a few years. So it's interesting to hear you talk about that, because I do think they're good. I just haven't found one necessarily that might be something that we could recommend. But anyway, it's good to know. Now, do you guys use parachutes as well?
We do.
Parachutes, yeah. And drag socks? Do you wear drag socks?
Oh, yes. We use the drag socks. It's some of the worst things. We used a lot for warm-up. We'll do the socks and mitts for as part of our opening 400. And then we use chutes on power days, chutes, socks, fins. We put the fins on and then put the socks over the fins. We'll do all that sort of stuff, but it will be very short. It'll be no longer than a 50 with that sort of stuff, just kind of going full speed, max effort.